All right.
Jason, Pamela, Clay, are we good now? Hey, Kelly, how are you? Craig, good to see you, or good to see your comments. All right, guys. As people start to join in, our apologies for, we were trying to figure out how to get this from my personal feed onto the 321 Go feed. I think we got it now. And so, welcome to the party. Dan, or is it Don? Don! That's one good-looking man. Josh, thank you. I appreciate that. All right, guys, so in the house, we have myself. Also, this is MDV. And this is Matt Walker. MDV plays a critical role in terms of operations, but also coach development. And Mr. Matt Walker came on board with us several years ago. He mainly focuses on operations and finance, and he has a background from Lockheed Martin before that. MDV obviously has a legal background, tons of experience, and we're here today just to answer your questions and go over a few different things. And so, without further ado, let's get this party started. Chad, what's up, man? So, for the last 6 weeks, I've been personally talking to gym owners from all around the world. I've been spending roughly 15 to 20 minutes with each one, and while I've done so, I've learned a lot. And we've also shared our insight. And so what we want to do today is just start touching base on a few of the questions that you guys have asked, and then also go into maybe some specific subjects that you guys might have comments on. With these two powerhouses in the room, I'm confident we can give you guys at least some guidance and direction to help you guys along your journey. So let's begin with the first question we were asked was, what is the number one most productive thing you've ever done to increase average revenue per member? So that's a really interesting question. And oftentimes when we think about this, is like, let's just say you have 50 members and you want to make more money per member, is your first thought process might be, okay, let me go ahead and start selling them drinks. Let me start selling them supplements or t-shirts or things of that nature. And that is a way of doing it, increasing the average price per member. The way we like to think about it is in terms of the average lifetime span of a member. And so when we break down our number one most productive thing we could do to increase average revenue, we don't look at it from a monthly basis, we look at it in terms of a lifetime basis. So how do we do that? Well, we get them to buy in more to the brand, right? Doing things like social events, doing things like investing in the coaching development so the product on the floor is as key and as dialed in as it can be. So this way, we're renewing them every single day. And so for us, the key for us to increase our average revenue per member is a long-term play for us, and it starts with the product on the floor and the experience you're offering them to buy into your brand to tell more friends about it. I want to look here. What is the number one most productive thing you've done to increase retention? For us, the number one thing that we've done to increase retention is, again, focusing on our business in terms of it being almost like a hospitality, in the sense that when you come in, it's a full experience from the moment you walk in to the moment you leave, and the critical piece of that would be the product on the floor. So investing in people like MDV and our other coaches, developing their skills by putting them through additional coaching development structure, from seminars and things of that nature, is a great way to focus on the product on the floor and to increase our member retention. At what point in your affiliateship did you begin paying yourself, and how did you go about deciding how much to pay yourself? It's a great question. I started paying myself about 6 months into the business, maybe a little bit less. I probably didn't do it the right way. I would just kind of pull money out of the business instead of actually going through a company like Paychecks or what's another one? There's Paychecks and there's ADP, all these different ones. Going through those payroll systems, I would recommend, because what they do is they take out the taxes for you. I would just pull the money and almost be a contractor, and it wasn't the best way of doing it. But it took me about 6 months to finally start paying myself, and I paid myself what I could. Which brings us to a really important topic, this revolving door system, okay? One of the things I've experienced from talking to so many gym owners on the phone lately is that maybe some of you guys have experienced this yourself. You're coaching 7, 8, 9 classes a day, and you're getting burnt out, and there's no one there to build your business. So my question to each one of you guys is simple. How is your time best spent? And so something I think you can reflect on after this Facebook Live session is, how is your time best spent? So for me, is my time best spent coaching the product on the floor, or am I better suited to have someone else do that and allow me to go outside the business to build the business? Is a great question. So for each one of you guys, you need to evaluate your strengths and weaknesses so you can better analyze what you should be doing with your time. A good way to also do this is to look at your class schedule and to see what type of classes are filled and which one aren't as filled. If your classes aren't as full, you may want to cancel that class and allocate that time to getting outside the gym to build your business. Because one of the problems we see based on all the calls we've made is that gym owners don't think they have the money to pay coaches. So they end up coaching all the classes themselves. But then there's no one there to build your business. So you need to evaluate where your time is best spent. I'm going to get to a few of these questions and hopefully tie in some of these guys here. Eli, what's up, man? Talking to you 2 weeks. What responsibility to give the operators at each location? Okay. So what have been the best ways to build your clientele? I'll give you a few ideas. Number one, focus on the product on the floor, right? Again, if your product isn't good, and if your on-ramp program isn't good, or your privates, or answering your phone. So it's answer your phone, answer email. If you don't have the time to allocate to that, find someone else who could do that, right? It's product on the floor, again, experience, but it's also doing member referrals, you know, perhaps some type of incentive. What we just did was a $100 gift card to Reebok for anyone that referred a new member. It was a good New Year's kind of promotion. That's something you guys could think about doing. Another thing you could do is follow up with cancellations, right? You know, if you've been in business 1 year, 2 year, average attrition, let's just say, is 2-3%. If you look at that number and follow up with them and explain the benefits you've been adding, that's a great way to get them back in the door and hopefully get them to sign up with you again. Let me see. Okay, so back to the business. So guys, if you have any more questions on the business, keep asking here, but I'm gonna keep going back on the ones you guys have already asked. Do you track profitability of each revenue stream, Mr. Walker?
Yes, absolutely. So what we do is we segregate accordingly in QuickBooks. So we'll use locations and classes within QuickBooks to specify, is this income part of membership dues, drop-ins, is it merchandise sales, and so forth with the expenses and the cost of goods sold.
How do you determine how much to pay a coach is the next question. The way we determine it is we have a job leveling criteria. And so I'll have MDV kind of shine light on a few of the job leveling criteria we incorporate, but that's a good way that when someone comes in, we say, hey, look, you're starting here with these expectations that MDV could talk about, but this is your path towards where you could go, right? So this way, when they come in, instead of saying, hey, work hard and you'll get good things, they actually know there's trajectory built into their business.
Hey guys, when we're talking about coach leveling criteria, we're really referring to a few different factors that will help grade a coach when they join your organization or move them up as they progress through your organization. So the first thing that we look at is years of experience. What do they come in? How many years have they coached? How long have they been on the floor? What's their level of current certificate or certification? Level 1, level 2, level 3, or that coveted level 4? Based on those two factors, we'll look to get them into an entry-level position with the company, and whether that's starting out at a lower grade, somewhere in the middle, or a higher grade. Now, as they get more responsibility within your organization, as they become better coaches, they gain more experience, they gain more, garner more certs or certifications, they might move up that scale. And things that we look for is, hey, is this coach really now adding value, not just on the floor from 0 minute to 60 minute, but now are they adding value to the entire organization, the whole community? Are they going outside of their scope? Are they becoming contributor to the bottom line of the business in other ways just besides coaching classes? And that, in a nutshell, is how we really formulate our criteria for coaching.
The next question we had was in regards to expanding your business. And so one of the things I'll start off with when in regards to expanding your business that's critical is, you know, is your first house clean, right, is the question. And if your business is running and it's profitable, that's great. But oftentimes through all the calls that I've made with different gym owners, is they're running a, you know, moderately profitable business and they decide to open up a second one. What happens is this location I was doing okay is now not doing as well between the two because you're dispersing your resources across the board. So my recommendation would be, time to expand would be when you're bursting at the seams, doing really well, and you have a key employee who needs an opportunity. That's a great time to look 10 to 15 minutes away and get a new location. Things that we think about is, where are they located off the highway? Where are they located at in terms of being close to businesses? Because people that work are making money, and that's a nice way for them to pay for their membership versus being as residential focused. We're generally more near businesses. Another question would be, can my current business afford to take on the cost of a new location and generate profit? That's going to be an individual case-by-case basis. For us, if you're looking at your net income, you're looking anywhere from, you know, what do you think, Matt, 20 to 30% net if your business is returning that?
For expansion?
Yeah, like if you're returning that, then you're ready for expansion.
Yeah, I would say that combined with are you operating efficiently, right? Look at your capacity and where your member base is related to that capacity. Just because you're returning certain financial figures doesn't necessarily mean it makes sense for you to open up multiple more locations.
What do you think about that question?
The question is, what are percentages of expenses for rent, payroll, and miscellaneous that you think make sense? You know, every business is going to be, again, a bit unique here. But in general, as a rule of thumb, we like to adhere to roughly about 20% of our net revenue being allocated towards rent, about 35% of it being allocated towards payroll expenses, and miscellaneous. Again, it depends on the expense.
Let me go ahead and get to some of your guys' questions here. Do you suggest outside opinions programming, or do you feel it's many minds that are in one bubble? So, Daniela, you're asking about programming. Programming is an interesting topic, specifically for our business, right? Because what we've realized over the years is that our demographic has shifted. So when we first opened CrossFit Santa Clara 10 years ago, the industry was different. Over the years, what we've had to do is pivot and adapt to the industry. Currently, what we did is we looked at all of our members globally, and we started evaluating how often they're coming in and what are their desired variance levels. So if you think CrossFit has the most level of variance, we recognize that not necessarily everyone has that same desire to have that type of variance. So we've created three programs with it: NC60, NC45, and NC30. And with the increased duration allows for more variance, whereas maybe in NC30 it's more wall balls, rowing, etc. 45 will incorporate a barbell now, and then 60 will be your traditional complex gymnastics and complex weightlifting. But in regards to taking outside support, we take this all internally because we have a team that develops our programming, spends a lot of time on it. We send out session plans and programming to all of our coaches worldwide so they deliver the same product. That consistency, especially for those of you asking about expanding, consistency in your operations in terms of your handbook, your setting expectations, different types of things is critical, but it's also critical in terms of programming and session plans. It's a great way to at least get the first step to ensure your product on the floor is as similar as possible. Do I think showers are necessary?
Kind of generally, or
I think you should probably generally take a shower. In general, yes, we believe that showers are necessary. To put in perspective, we've opened many locations that did not have showers, and we took the time to and the money to invest in showers. Anywhere between 10 and 20K, depending on where you live, depending on different space. But we do believe that morning group and that midday group, it does drive a return. Is it the most important characteristic right off the bat? I can't necessarily say that. But as you grow, I think it's an important piece to add into your business.
Yeah, and we also surveyed the members, right, and found out that it was really important to them.
Right.
Especially at our locations that are more commuter kind of
focused. Yeah. As we mentioned, we try and have a tendency to open up near businesses. For those people that are coming in and then going to work, it was important for them to have a shower, and that's one of the biggest reasons why, after polling them, we decided to add them. How do you get new programs off the ground? Just do some social media advertising? Well, so the question is, how do you get new programs off the ground? And in regards to new programs, I'm not quite sure exactly what you're referencing, but for us, we'll use an example when we incorporated NC30, which is our 30-minute express-style class, get in a great workout, get back with your day. The first thing we learned is to make sure that we had a clear definition of what we were offering. The second thing is to get your staff to understand why you're offering it. And then once we were ready to promote it, we created content for our members, right? We got them on board. We said, hey, this is what we're bringing. We did flyers. We did social media through Facebook groups, things of that nature. And then we did our big punch, right? We did social media. We did flyers, different places. We went out and to local businesses and share with them the new types of programs we're offering. And in general, when we incorporate a new offering, what we try and do is not take away an existing offering. We try and add it so it's more value add for our members versus them feeling like we're taking something away from them. MDV, this is a good question for you.
Yeah.
What are your top three courses or seminars to look at for growing your coaches?
Top three seminars or courses for growing your coaches. And number one, completely foundational, would be the level one. It is an absolutely amazing Jason and I both coached on the level one staff for quite a long time. They've done a lot to invest in that and to make it as robust as you can, but it is only the introduction to becoming a coach. You have to really get out there, practice your skills, continue to revisit their level one curriculum, study it, master it. There's really no replacement for becoming the best coach you can within that breadth and depth of knowledge. Some of the best coaches in the world simply have their level one, and it's because they've invested a lot of time and energy into becoming the best coach in the world. Now, beyond that, the level two is a tremendous opportunity to get your coaches more experience at teaching, seeing, correcting in front of a small group and under the watchful eye of a master trainer. I would recommend having at least 700 hours of coaching experience before going into that. So that means you're coaching probably at least 2 or 3 years before stepping into a level two environment. The biggest mistake that I see with people going to take their level two is getting it into too early and not having the base level of knowledge that they need to get the proper feedback out of the level two course. You come out of the level two and you're saying, I didn't learn anything, I thought it was meaningless. You probably didn't go into it with the right mindset, or you didn't go into it with enough experience to make it meaningful. The level three, obviously, after that is a really, really valuable course, but it's more of the test-based course. You have to study a whole lot for that. The breadth of knowledge that you have to pass the level three is huge. It's everything within the CrossFit Journal, everything in the level one, level two, and then you really have to know it back and forth. It's not just, hey, how well do you coach? It's your understanding of how well you apply that to a group. Those would be my recommendations.
To add to what MDV is talking about, what I would share with you is that, yes, one, two, three, we're huge fans. But I also think that you need to take the onus on yourself as the owner, right, to make sure that you're offering tools for your staff. We just gave a book out yesterday to our staff to inspire, to have them at least create some type of engagement where they can start thinking about these things. And I think as the owner, you need to go out there and set an example for your people, right? Go take your level two, go take your level three. How can you expect it of them if you haven't done it yourself? And then also just constant improvement, YouTube, journal, different types of things. And then sharing that knowledge back to your team, I think, is critical.
Yeah.
Is your programming based on the CrossFit methodology, one-on, one-off, or more based on? Our programming methodology is based off what we've seen over the last 10 years with thousands of members and getting their feedback. That's what it's based off of. For us, we have the three programs. Our NC60 is designed to have the highest level of variance and complexity, but it's not going to be one-on, one-off. We're not going to program three-on, one-off. It just wasn't typical for our member base. And so long time ago, we realized that three-on, one-off just was not practical, and we had to shift to a seven-day-a-week program because we don't know when people are coming in. And that same thing applies for other programs. But I think evaluating your program offerings and asking yourself, what do your members want? And then start tailoring your programming and adjusting to open the doors. If you know, a good example is MMA. When MMA came on the scene with the UFC, right, a lot of people got excited about mixed martial arts. They went into these gyms and they learned very quickly that getting punched in the face was not that enjoyable, myself in particular, right? So some of these gyms, they also incorporated a lower complexity class where it was more bag work, more tie pad work, and this encouraged people to come in and train that, and then if they desired, to go into those other classes. For us, it's the same idea. Come in, get rooted in foundational movements, functional movements, good quality coaching, and then if you desire, come in for other classes, right? We always have a way for you to work up the ladder, but if you don't want to go up the ladder, start at the bottom. It's all good. Outside of CrossFit Inc. courses, what do you internally for your coaching development?
Yeah.
Do you want to talk about
that? Yeah, for sure. So for coaching development, guys, I really spearhead that now for the entire organization. And what we do is we've set out to become the best coaches in the world. That's our mission statement. And we do so by creating a culture of feedback where it is okay to give and receive feedback on a daily basis. It's okay to be watching one another, take each other's classes, to give suggestions, to be open to it. Obviously, you want to balance that against always having your coaches under the gun, always having your coaches being watched, being evaluated. But we really work hard to instill that coach culture of feedback among all of our coaches. In particular, among our head coaches and our operators, those guys are in positions of leadership. So they're going out there on the floor. They must lead by example. They have to set the standard, set the expectation for all the other coaches. And then they also have to know how to give and receive feedback in a really expert way. Now, not only are feedback loops extremely important, but having those expectations laid out on paper about what you're looking for out of your coaches, what you're looking for out of your classes, what are those expectations to continue to drive excellence forward, not just in, hey, you show up on time and you end class on time. That's showing up to work. But how do you intro the class? What is the expectations of a good warm-up? What are the expectations of a good skill session? How do we want to introduce new movements? What are we doing for scaling options? All those things need to be considered on a day-to-day basis for every class that you coach. And that's a big part of why we started to put out these session plans for our coaches. It gives them the opportunity to plan their classes ahead of time, to look at the session plan that we lay out, and then to go out there and coach the best possible 30-minute, 45-minute, 60-minute class. And we are constantly trying to improve ourselves. So feedback, expectations, and clear standards.
Where do you see NCFIT in 10 years from now, 25 years from now? I see NCFIT continuing to evolve. And I think as a business, 10 years ago, we opened up with one location, 1,000 square feet. We have 20 locations, a lot corporate, some open to the public. We are now working into the digital space, which we're really excited to announce today, before anything, the NCFIT Collective. And the collective we're really excited about, bringing like-minded people together, creating a way where we could offer the tools that we've used over the last 10 years and sharing with other business owners. So where do we see the NCFIT 10 years from now, 20 years from now? I see us trying to do the right thing for the right reason for our people. We started off this business, I want to do what I love for a living and provide that to as many people as possible. Then with them, they could then help a greater community. And I think we've been doing that. I think we could always do a better job. But in the future, I want to continue that. We want to create opportunities for our staff and then have them create a great culture for our members so that everybody gets fit, happy, and we can move on and do philanthropic efforts in the pediatric cancer. That's obviously a very passionate thing of mine. In Kauai, Hey, Samuel, go ahead and message me offline, and we'll go ahead and talk about your space in Kauai. But, well, actually, let's talk about it. No one knows where I'm at. I'm off the beaten path. This comes up very often. I talked to, I think, 10 business owners the last couple days who all said, hey, I'm in a warehouse down an alleyway. What do I do? And the reality is the onus is on you, right, to let people know about what you're offering. And if you offer an incredible product, you should want to go scream from the hilltops about what you're doing. But if you just stay in your gym and expect people to walk in, it's highly unlikely that people are going to walk into your gym and just sign up. It might happen through referrals, but what I'd recommend is, again, allocating time out of your day to walk out of your gym, go nearby businesses, put a fishbowl and offer a 1 month free membership if you put your business card in. Get out on social media and create content that educates and shares, right? So they share with their friends. Go talk to local businesses and set up lunch and learns. Set up coffee meet and greets where you go out and you say, hey, I'm Jim XYZ down the street. We offer these programs. I'd love to come and talk to your employees and offer them a free banana bread breakfast, right? And all I want to do is just share with them what we do, right? But those are the things that are going to build your business. Sitting in there and just waiting for people to come in, if you have two members in a class, it's not going to happen. And if you don't have the skills to do that, that's fine. Find someone else to go out there and share your business, because if you're not, then who is? Do we find a lot of our employees are previously members who find passion in coaching? Basically, for us in the beginning, it started off a lot where it was our members who became passionate in coaching, then became coaches. Now, as the business has become more professionalized and as we've grown, we now are attracting coaches who are coaches, and that's the way we're doing it currently for the most part. But I still believe that a person who develops within our system is critical to get to understand the culture and the values that we have in place. And so we've just started a new internship program that we're really proud of. Do you want to share about the internship program?
Sure.
Let's talk about the internship program.
So we just, like Jason was saying, started two programs. One is an internship, which is a little bit more formal on both sides of the equation, where the interested coach has their level one certificate. They can commit a certain number of hours each week to being involved in learning the nitty-gritty of what it is to become a coach. It's a super in-depth process on our side. It has five phases, and it can last up to 100 hours. And you go all the way from who we are, what we do, and why we do it, all the way through seeing, teaching, correcting, presence, and attitude, and building the best possible classes. So within that 100 hours, there's a whole lot of learning that happens. The apprentice program on the other side of it, guys, is for people who want to peek behind the curtain, who are not level one certificate holders, or who maybe have their level one but aren't really interested in stepping onto the floor as a coach just yet. That's fine as well. We can give you an introduction to what our coaches are doing on a day-to-day basis. They observe classes. They get an opportunity to interact with their coach after. But it's also crucial for us that if our coaches are spending time with these individuals to help develop them, that those individuals are now jumping back in and adding value to the community. So every minute that those guys are in the gym for observation, they also have to give back time to us, whether it's cleaning the facility, maintaining the equipment, investing in the membership, you know, doing inventory, all those things that coaches really do on a day-to-day basis, not just the super sexy stuff, going out there, coaching a toes-to-bar, coaching the clean, or whatever like that, but also, like, coaches on the off hours, that's mostly what they're doing, so we want to give them that introduction as well.
So on that same note, guys, I want to kind of shift from the coaching product to now a little bit more on the business side of things. When we get on the phone, one of the things I recognize is that there's a lot of areas where there's a lot of risk and liability. And one of the concepts I want to share with you is this idea of adjusted profit based on risk. And when we speak to people on the phone, one of the concerns I have is that a lot of these gym owners are making, let's just say, $500, $1,000, $2,000 a month. And on surface, okay, you're making money. That's good. The problem is when you adjust that income for the risk that's associated from having all these people in your doors, from injuries, from employees, it starts to be not as optimal, right? When you adjust your income based on risk, it's something for you to think about. Matt's just going to share, well, I want him to share just one quick thing on the employee versus contractor thing and when coaches are not getting paid.
Sure.
So it's very important that your employees, your coaches, your front desk staff are classified appropriately from an employment perspective. So ensuring that people are properly classified as W-2 employees if you are setting their schedule, if you are managing them in terms of performance evaluation and so forth. If you're going to classify somebody as a contractor in general, you need to make sure that that person has a business license, they carry their own insurance, they are setting their own schedules, and they are supporting other businesses as well. If you are not properly classifying people, that is a significant risk that you should be aware of.
How about the not paid coaches?
Like unpaid
people
coaches?
People are coaching.
Sure. So as a rule of thumb, when it comes to supporting anyone that really is acting on our company's behalf, we want to make sure that they're covered under all of our insurances. So even if they are an apprentice or an intern, whether they're paid or not, we need to ensure that they are carried under our payroll so that they are covered under our insurances so that, you know, we are mitigating that risk.
Perfect.
So guys, we want to kind of cut this off the next 5 minutes. I'm going to look through some of your questions. Let me go ahead and see if we can answer some of these fire chat. This, do you think about PT before group class model? Yeah, I think private on-ramping is a great bet, especially for your gyms that aren't getting groups of 5 or 10 or 20 people. If you're just getting one-off, right, I think a private is a great way to go, because you start giving the, you know, more of an individualized experience, which I think is key. Let me keep going. What are you using video content? Example, Imam of the Day, iPhone. Do you have a plan for this content, or just make it on when you can? For us, when we think about content, we think about what is value-added, right? What kind of value-added content can we share with our community and with our coaches? So every day in our session plans now, right, we incorporate a video for that day. And so our coaches worldwide get an intro, a timeline, stimulus, all the different things, the warm-up, right, the work of the day, but also a video sharing like a quick tip. MDV and I just filmed some, and one of the ones that I shared was, for example, hey, when I coach the shoulder press, I like to use these three terms, brace, chin, press. And it's just giving our coaches tools to then offer, again, a consistent experience across the board. You know, when you look at gym owners who have multiple gyms, sometimes the consistency starts to drop off. One of the ways we manage that is through our programming and our session plans. Hey, Don, I got a couple of smart dudes sitting next to me. That's right, we do. This guy over here and this guy over here, they're smart people. And that goes into one very important concept. Know what you know and know what you don't know. When Matt first came on, Walker, the only way I knew we were making money was by looking in our bank account. I kid you not, I had no idea what was making money, what wasn't. But the bank account was going like this, so I figured we were doing well. Problem is, we had some areas of the business that weren't doing that well. But I couldn't identify it because I didn't segment out the business. Once Matt segmented out the business and we started looking at it, our profitability started to increase because we recognized areas that we needed to make drastic improvements on, which is a good model for you guys to think about. If there's something that's keeping you up at night, right? If there's an issue, concern, address it. Don't just let it go off, because at the end of the day, this isn't a hobby for us. This is a business. We're taking on a lot of risk and liability, and we ultimately are not running a nonprofit. There is nonprofit stuff that I do, but that's not this business, right? That's outside. Jason, can you speak to member management? In other words, do you have policies to follow up with members? Yeah, do you want to talk to that? Like following up with members?
Sure. Yeah, so we have tried to develop formal processes for nearly every type of member engagement in terms of, you know, how we handle inquiries, how we onboard members. When someone wants to put their membership on hold, how we go about that. If they want to cancel, what does that cancellation or that retention effort look like? So we have literally created Visio charts where we identify the different stakeholders that are involved in the process, whether it be the operator of the sites, whether it be our member relationships team, and so forth. and have identified, you know, where the decision points are and who's going to be responsible for what, so that we make sure that there is consistency every single time.
If you want some, in the future, some of the things we're talking about, some of the docs will be a part of the collective. We're going to have this thing called the Collective Corner, where weekly we're going to put out information, kind of like what you're hearing right now, but then we're also going to share actual documents, because we spent a lot of time and a lot of effort on these, and we want to be able to share them with our community, the future NCFIT Collective. One last question. What kind of equipment would you suggest? Here's a great way to look at equipment. What's used the most, right? Get that first. What's used the least, get that last. Meaning GHD, sure, it's cool, but for the most part, to have a class run on it, it's challenging. I would maybe have one to teach spinal flexion extension. I think it's valuable for that. But if you try and get five or six, it takes up a lot of floor space for how often it's utilized, right? What is used a lot? Dumbbells, kettlebells, wall balls, barbells, plates, a rig, that's used a lot. Then such things as rowers, bikes, and then from there you can move on. Skiers would probably fall down the totem pole. So we had to evaluate what money you want to spend. When I first opened the gym, I had $5,000. I built my own pull-up rig from Home Depot, right, which was interesting. Had one guy break a bar one time, fell on his back. It was really embarrassing. It was terrible, actually. And then I got dumbbells, barbells, and as I made more money, as the business grew, I started investing more in equipment. So guys, that's about 45 minutes we've been chatting. For more information, visit nc.fit/collective. That's going to be our new thing we're rolling out. Really excited and really appreciate Clay letting us get on. Hopefully we can do this again another time. Got some really smart dudes in the room. We just want to share knowledge and experience over the last 10 years and what we've learned. Hope you guys have a great day and keep growing your business.